to the remote location filing, which is advantage whereby you can sit in New York and clear entries in LA just with a stroke of the keyboard. Sounds easy? Not so. Because there are limitations that you see throughout. There are limitations on the type of entries. So if it's anti-dumping entry, you will not be able to do that. If it's quota entry, you will not be able to do that. If I believe if you don't have continuous bond, if you just have single entry bond, you will not be able to do that. There are a bunch of restrictions and customs, but it's a huge benefit because it allows you to concentrate your employees, if you are the corporate broker, in one place and just keep on filing entries, which what has been done by and large. You have seen the for front runner, UPS, who consolidated many of its filers in one location, I think three locations. Now I think it went down. Then followed by Bax Global, then followed by other big players, Schenker, I believe, DHL, well, now DHL is mostly out. And many other huge corporate brokers who have been consolidating and closing down a lot of their offices because they prefer central location. But again, it's voluntary and optional, and you don't have to do that. However, if you do decide to do that, to file remotely, one of the key requirements is to have a national permit. Number one, you get a license. Number two, you get a district permit. Number three, you get the national permit. Now, these steps, customs will ask you about, or may ask you about. But most likely, they will not ask you about in the context that you have to do this, this, and that. They will ask you, they give you the fact pattern, and they'll say, how much in fees do you have to pay? So you have to know how much are the fees for the district permit, plus a national permit, plus a broker's license. And where do you find that? Well, we just seen part 111, right? $111.96 deals with the fees, and fees tend to go up. So those of you who go back to the old, when you do your review and practice with the old questions, your numbers may not match because the fees have been different back in 2000 as opposed to today. It's not because you're doing something wrong, but the current schedule of fees, $138 for the permit. Which does it include national permit? Yes, it does. So district permit, 138 plus a national permit, 138. $100 is a triennial status report fee. In customs exam, you may see it referred to as triennial fee because you have to pay that fee every 3 years. And all it is a form that says you have or have not been convicted of any criminal activity, and you continue to engage in customs business. It's a professional requirement, and so it's not enough. So you think you're done passing customs broker exam and applying for the fee? No. Every 3 years, you have to pull out your wallet and pay $100. All right. Notice, when you file for the permit, unless you're doing it concurrently with the license, you have to pay another fee, which is $100. So if I want to start a business, I'm a license, I'm entering into the new market, I need to pay $100 application fee, and then I need to pay $138 license fee. And then if I want to go national, I need to pay another $138. Everyone sees that? So those are not exclusive of each other. Those are in addition to. Any this is important. Any questions on this one? Customs been asking about this stuff, guys. So please know that if I want to open up my business, I have to pay, and I'm brand new with a license. I have a let's say I want to expand from New York to Boston. In Boston, I pay $100, $138. But if I want to expand nationally, I need to pay another additional $138. Yeah.
So those $100 only for the permit application, right?
Yeah, kind of like.
Local or national? For both, or is each one I need to pay $100 for application?
That's a good question. I believe both, if I'm not mistaken.
Oh, for $100 for each, right?
For yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah,
because the pressure
for each permit. However, wait, under 117. Wait. 117. Yeah, national permit is under 117, so yes. I wanted to double check, because if national permit would be not in 111.17 but 111.19, let's say, it would have different rule structure, but yes.
So first time you pay
$400 something? You pay a good chunk of money. And there are questions on it. Go through your questions.
Yeah.
And there are questions just dealing with that. They say, like, Joe the broker is expanding his business, or Joe the broker is would like to open up a new office, and he does this, this, and that. He also would like to set up RLF, which is the topic of our discussion today. And therefore, he needs to pay so much in fees, and they give totals in answer question. Of course, to refer to the total, you must know the fee breakdown. And that's the focus of the question. Okay, let's go back, let's go forward. So for RLF to file remotely, you need to meet this criteria at the very least. So you have to have ABI. So ABI is a so to make it RLF, remote location filing, you do that through ABI. You go on ABI and you file remotely. So it's a must. EIP. Modules of the automated transmit detail invoice through ABI. Automated. So, I suppose you need to have that, which is a software which will allow you to transmit invoices. Nothing difficult about this, it's just a bunch of labels that we need to be mindful of. How do we do with the labels? Well, one thing I suggest is, you see the textbook Web Supplement chapter 25. That's the, I send out the list with the passwords. One thing you can do, those who have a book need not to worry about it, but one thing I suggest is to go through the flashcards and just print them out and just shuffle them through on your subway. Those are pretty easy flashcards to remember, and the rehearsal will just make your life easier. Again, it's over here under textbook, chapter 25. Along with other appendices. Another thing I mentioned, continuous bond. So RLF entry must be secured with a continuous bond. What does it mean? What's the dollar limit amount? Minimum dollar limit for continuous bond is $50,000. So you must have a volume to be RLF operational in the first place. It cannot be one-time deal. If not, then you just FedEx the documents or use the outboard broker to do that if it's a small time entries. Otherwise, obtain a continuous bond. Let's see. So I suppose this is something which I don't think I talked about too much. Line release or BRAS procedure. This was something. This is a procedure adopted for repetitive shipments, like electronic shipments that are manufactured in Maquiladora and being brought in. They have special rules. I have a separate chapter for them. They are not frequently tested, so I don't think it's worth talking about it. But if you're doing RLF, you cannot do line release, and you cannot do immediate delivery. So if you do it remotely, you cannot apply for the special permit for immediate delivery permit, meaning that you cannot bring fresh strawberries under the permit. You have to do the entry. And you cannot do the line release procedures. The next question deals just with that. So the eligibility question for RLF says, which is not, again, a typical question by customs examiners. We have a bunch of data that you just must know. No brainer here, just a bunch of data. You must know your references. A, B, C, D, the one which is not is you must submit line release or immediate delivery. Well, we just stated you must not. Exactly the opposite, and it's just buried in the middle of the answers. Continuous bond requirement, it's required. National permit, we know. EII, we know because electronic invoice program, part of electronic invoice program, EIP, is required because you need to submit those invoices electronically, right, to the other ports. And must be operational by on ABI. We know that is true. So this is the outlier. So there are two ways to answer it. You either know that this is wrong, or you either know that all those others are correct. Which one do you guys think is easier? To go with the wrong ones or to go with the ones that are correct? With the wrong one? I think in my position, I think it's much easier to go with this one because we talked about continuous bond so much. National permit, we covered in 111. ABI, well, we talked about this to some extent today, but we know it's an umbrella for all other, well, ACS is a top umbrella, right? But ABI, as far as brokers are concerned, is an umbrella for other requirements. So I think here is to check would be much easier in my situation rather than to actually know that the line release is not required. But again, it's individual preference.